Coming up on this edition of Quincy in Focus.
And it inspires fear as well as respect, often in equal measures.
The first John Noonan Senior Forum is held at the Kennedy Center.
If you don't let it cool down, the hot oil is hot enough to reignite on its own.
A senior fire safety workshop is presented by the Quincy Fire Department.
We are doing this presentation of Ambassador for Peace Medal in honor of our Korean War veterans.
And Quincy veterans are honored by the government of South Korea. All this and more coming up on Quincy in Focus.
Hello, and welcome to Quincy Access Television's monthly news magazine show, Quincy in Focus. My name is Vanessa Rizzitano, and I am a senior intern from Curry College. Please join me as we take a look at the events that have recently happened this past month in Quincy. Coming up on this edition, many people participated in this year's annual City of Presidents 5K Walk and Run to benefit the Quincy Public Schools. We will also take a look at a press conference held by Governor Charlie Baker announcing an $85 million grant toward infrastructure improvements throughout the state. Leading off this edition, celebrating its 70th year, Interfaith Social Services is a nonprofit organization center that consists of a thrift shop, a bookstore, and a food pantry to provide goods for Quincy families in need.
My name is Rick Doane. I'm the Executive Director of Interfaith Social Services. And here at Interfaith, we are a one-stop shop for families in need. So we have a food pantry, mental health counseling center. We have eviction prevention programs. We have one of the best thrift shops on the South Shore. And we're here for when people need help. This year we're celebrating our 70th anniversary. So we were founded here in Quincy when the South Shore was going through a crisis. And over the years, we have adopted programs to help families in need, especially children. So one of the things we've done over the past few years is found ways we can bring children more joy. So it's Halloween costumes that we distribute to hundreds of kids, it's Easter baskets, it's Christmas, it's back to school backpacks. You know, our food pantry and some of our bedrock programs have been around for 40 years or 70 years, but something over the past few years that we've done is really added more programs to bring joy to the children that we serve. During the summer is one of our busiest times of the year. So during the holidays is when everybody in the community is thinking about hunger, and we're grateful for it because we have a lot of clients who come in that need help that are trying to make ends meet, and this time of year is extra difficult. You have a luxury meal like Thanksgiving, where you have all those expenses that go into a meal, and you have Thanksgiving and Christmas and all of those things. But one of the busiest times that people don't think about is the summer. During the summer, when kids are out of school, they're not getting a free breakfast, they're not getting a free lunch, and families depend on our services to get help. We serve 10 towns on the South Shore. Quincy is one of the communities that most relies on our services. After that, it's Braintree, Weymouth, Randolph, but we serve all the way down to Hull, Cohasset, Scituate. We serve 10 towns in the greater South Shore area. We have two full-time employees, and we have a number of part-time program managers, but we are unique in the fact that we rely heavily on volunteers. We have 120 volunteers coming in every week to serve at our front desk, in our food pantry, in our thrift shop. Volunteers from corporate groups are coming in, Blue Cross Blue Shield, Arbella, Boston Financial, Quincy businesses that really support us. They send 800 volunteers every year. So we could not serve our clients without the volunteers who come in. So food comes from a variety of sources. About half of it comes from the Greater Boston Food Bank, which has a contract for federal and state food and large food salvage programs. We go in and we pick up about 5,000 pounds a week there. But the other half of our food comes from food salvage. So our food rescue van is out on the road 5 days a week going to Big Y, to Roach Brothers, to BJ, to Stop and Shop, to Trader Joe's, to Star Market, going to all of these places, picking up food that otherwise would have gone to waste that we're able to bring to our clients. Also, donations from the community. We have people every day that walk into our offices with bags of food from their church, from community, from their family, and we need all of that working together to provide food for our clients. This is our 70th anniversary, and so we have our 70th, we're celebrating that with our 20th anniversary Feed the Hungry Gala, and that's coming up on December 8th. And we have more information on our website, interfaithsocialservices.org.
Around 24 Korean War veterans were recognized and thanked for their service at a ceremony that was held at City Hall. These veterans were recognized by the government of South Korea as awards and medals were handed out during the ceremony.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for coming today. My name is George Nicholson. I'm the Director of Veteran Services for the City of Quincy. And I am honored to be able to host this particular occasion so that the people of the Republic of South Korea can pay honor and a special little debt of recognition, which to them is eternal, to the Korean War veterans that we have here today.
It's certainly an honor and privilege to serve as the mayor of this great city of Quincy. And every time I come in this room, it's hard not to think about the great history that this room invokes. And you know, you look out the window in the burial ground of our forefathers out here. Across the street, the presidents are buried. And certainly this room, since 1844, people of all walks of life have come through this building to serve their city. Many of them served their nation, going back to the Revolutionary War. In fact, the first mayor of Quincy was a Civil War veteran, a decorated Civil War veteran. So there's great pride in the city of Quincy and great tradition in honoring our veterans. And today is another example of that. So we're grateful to, again, the government of South Korea for acknowledging the incredible sacrifice made by the veterans from the United States to protect freedom for the people of South Korea. And certainly as mayor, on behalf of the citizens of the city of Quincy, I want to say thank you for your service.
Many of the Korean War veterans we met during this year, they memorized one or two Korean words. One is 안녕하세요, which means, anybody remember 안녕하세요 among Korean War veterans? Okay, it is a hi. And 감사합니다, it's a thanks. So I like to say 안녕하세요, 감사합니다, which means hello, thank you. We are doing this presentation of Ambassador for Peace Medal in honor of our Korean War veterans, not only in United States, but also around the world. Countries that participated in 1950 Korean War.
We all believe that democracy and freedoms we enjoy today should be something that is shared around the world beyond us. It is true that if you have a democracy, you have a free country, you have a strong economy, and you have people who are willing to engage other people around the world and engage in trade and education and communication. And I did a visit to Korea in 2014 as an official guest of the Korean government, and it was quite enlightening to see how much they are like us and how much they are not. They adopted many things of the rest of the world, but in heart, they are truly Korean, holding on to their culture, their people, their language, and even a desire to be one country again.
I'm very honored when George asked me to say a few words here today. As he said, the American Legion, being the largest war veterans organization in the world, and in Seoul, Korea, we have three American Legion posts that are situated in Korea. Those veterans that have gone back home, that served with us during the war, in our side of the war, they form Legion posts like they do here in Quincy with the Marisette and the Squanum and House Neck, Quincy. So we're very much a part of the Korean establishment.
Hundreds of runners participated in this year's fourth annual City of Presidents 5K road race held in remembrance of Central Middle School teacher Emily Zarnock. Proceeds from the race will benefit the Quincy Public Schools health and wellness programs.
All the money proceeds from today goes right back into our school system for health and wellness programs. And we know in this day and age how important that is. So we're grateful for your support here this morning. And let's have a great day. Now we're going to hear from our young people as we do our national anthem.
And the rock is red glare, the bombs thirsty in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say, does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the
Thanks for coming out on such a beautiful day. I just want to say a couple of words. I hope you all have a great race. After the race, after the ceremony, we are going to get as many Emily Zarnock fans together up at her memorial bench, which is just up outside of the Central Middle School, for a group picture. So you're all welcome, and I hope to see you there.
Day. You know, I want to thank so many of our business partners, Blue Cross Blue Shield in particular, and the mayor's office, the Zarnock family. Just a wonderful day for a wonderful cause, and so many of the funds go right directly towards so many of our initiatives with substance use and abuse. So we're thrilled to be here today and take advantage of the day, the weather, and some wonderful, wonderful people. So thank you.
I'm a sixth grade teacher at Central Middle School, and that's the school that Emily Zarnock was a staff member of. And today's really just a great day to remember her enthusiasm in the hallways every day, the way she treated the kids, the way she always had that, just a wonderful positive attitude. And we're fortunate enough every day to walk by a bench that's dedicated to her. So she's always in our memory. She's always right here on our shirts. And just a wonderful, wonderful person.
Ward 2 Quincy City Councilor Brad Crowell presented Dennis Sweeney, the owner and operator of Dennis Sweeney Funeral Home, with a commendation in recognition of celebrating 100 years in business.
At this time, I'd like to recognize Councilor Crowell up at the podium. Councilor Crowell and I are doing this jointly, but he is doing it from the podium on our together behalf. Councilor Crowell.
Thank you very much, Madam President. It is with a tremendous amount of enthusiasm and joy that I have the opportunity here to present a commendation to my friend, our friend, Dennis Sweeney. As many folks know, he owns and operates the Sweeney Funeral Home located on Elm Street, and he is, or the firm is celebrating 100 years of being in business. Mr. Sweeney, when he comes up, you'll see he looks pretty good for 100. But in all sincerity, he is he's a very genuine man. I've known him for quite some time. You know, he's very active in the city. He's an asset to the business community, and I think above and beyond, you know, provides a tremendous amount of dignity and respect to those individuals and families during, obviously, sometimes the most trying situations when they're dealing with you know, a death. So, again, excited to have Mr. Sweeney here this evening. I'd like to read the commendation that the City Council will be presenting, which reads as follows. In recognition of 100 years of business in the City of Quincy, we honor your extraordinary commitment to your staff, customers, and community over those 100 years. Your countless acts of kindness and dedication to customers helped generations through some of the most difficult times of their lives. May your services continue to serve generations of Quincy residents. You are a true friend to the City of Quincy, and we are truly grateful for your dedication and commitment. So with that, Mr. Sweeney, I'd like to you know, welcome you to the microphone to accept the commendation and, you know, perhaps say a few words to your raving fans tuning in at home.
We're the oldest funeral home in the City of Quincy, and actually the second oldest business left in the City of Quincy. And as you can see what embalming fluid does, I've done well for 100 years. So thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
A lieutenant and captain from the Quincy Fire Department held their first fire prevention meeting for the elderly at the Kennedy Center here in Quincy.
First of all, I'd like to talk about smoke alarms. Sometimes people, you know, there's bedrooms on the first floor and second floor. So in addition, you're going to need, just to keep it simple, you're going to need them outside every bedroom in the bottom of each stairway leading upstairs. That's where you need the smoke detectors. The CO detectors, the only rule of the smoke detector, the level where you have the bedrooms, it has to be within 10 feet of the bedroom, it's a CO detector. And CO detectors also, you can plug them into the wall. All the smoke detectors have to be on the ceiling, but the CO detectors can be, you know, they plug in, they can be attached to the wall, or they can be part of, sometimes they, you know, they get the smoke detector and the CO detector in one unit.
So you get the holidays coming up, probably going to be doing a lot of cooking in the kitchens, and there's a lot of little things and some bigger things that are safety issues. One big thing, people cooking with loose clothing, hanging over the stoves, catch fire. You're going quick, you use a dish towel, you wipe your hands off, you throw it down on the counter, but it's kind of leaning because your stove and your counter kind of come together. Towels catch fire. Grease fire, in general, oven mitt, a lid, come from the side. You want to put it right on top of the fire. It's going to smother it from the oxygen. It's going to prevent oxygen from getting in, it's going to smother the fire. You want to turn the burner on. Do not take the lid off. Let it cool down. If you don't let it cool down, the hot oil is hot enough to reignite on its own. So you say, okay, the fire's out, I'm going to take my cover off. Everything's good. You turn it back, it goes right back up. So leave it out. Don't be afraid. Call 911. We'll come. We'll give it a look over, make sure everything's out, everything's good, you know, because fire can extend into walls and things like that, even if it was a quick one and you got it out fast.
So a lot of times, the old grease on the bottom will catch fire. So you want to keep it clean. Any kind of like a grease fire, I mean, you don't want to plunge. I'd say stay away from using the fire extinguisher because you're going to be plunging it into the liquid on the stove, on the grease. And it's going to put it up, and it's also going to splash it out of the pan or whatever it's in. The pan's here, and you slide the cookie sheet on top rather than going on with the lid like that. So if you get a big enough cookie sheet, put that on.
Don't try to pick it up and get it to the sink. Oh, Jesus, on fire, I got to get it over to the sink. Do not move it. Do not lift it. Leave it where it is. Cover it. If you don't have a cover, can't get to it, extinguishers. You know, if you have that handy, if you think that's the best route, if you can't get to a cover to put out your fire, all else fails, get out.
Yeah.
Just get out, call 911, and we'll come and take care of it.
Yeah.
Smoking outside is always just your best bet. Ashtrays, deep and wide, make sure everything's extinguished, never smoke in bed. All the obvious, and another thing is, you know, with older people, a lot of people are on oxygen. Oxygen and fire, not good. Smoking, keep it away from anybody that has portable oxygen tanks or anything like that in their homes.
Director of Elder Services Thomas Clasby spoke at the Kennedy Center during the first annual John Noonan Senior Forum. Clasby talked about the highlights from a senior conference that he recently attended.
This conference and now forum named after John Noonan. Those of you who remember John knew that he was always on the cutting edge of anything that was going on in the aging community. I borrowed heavily from Dr. Thomas and from a booklet from AARP called Disrupt Aging, and from one of my fellow alum of the Franciscan University, motivational speaker, Matthew Kelly, who comes from Australia. But I wanted to share these thoughts with you because when we had Dr. Thomas come and do his theatrical presentation, how many of you were here for that? I know some of you were here for that and you followed. I was profoundly touched by it. And it reminded me of what's sometimes in scripture, the Jewish people had called a metanoia, which is a conversion of mind and heart, a different way of looking at things, simply put. And so he brought me and us to a point where we would look at things a different way. We are all navigating a passage to a slower, deeper, and more connected life. The world is racing to a future that is old. Of all the people who have ever reached the age of 65, half are alive today. Aging is powerful, and it inspires fear as well as respect, often in equal measures. The wisdom of a multi-generational social structure is undeniably global and deserving of a word of its own, and Dr. Thomas gives us that word as eldertopia. This is a community capable of creating well-being for people of all ages, strengthening and improving the means by which the young protect, sustain, and nurture their elders, and the elders contribute richly to the well-being of the young. Contemporary critics of aging often claim that growing old is a luxury we cannot afford. The most short-sighted among them want us to abandon the ancient patterns of exchange that connects the young and the very young to the old and the very old. They forget that wisdom outweighs wealth. Our researchers answer that all dynamic and self-balancing systems have a reserve capacity. In youth, our bodies are well supplied with energy we need to contain and overcome the stresses forced upon us by our own environment. As we age, this reserve capacity declines at about 1% each year. The new happiness and gradual acceptance of mortality is not unrelated. The law of averages insists that on any given day, people living with a smaller reserve capacity will be more likely to encounter a fatal stressor than people with a larger reserve capacity. And this is why the mortality rate rises with age. Never assume we have nothing left to give. It's not a matter of faith. It's a matter of human values is what it is. It's a matter of respect for human life, and it's a matter of care and community.
Governor Charlie Baker made a stop in Quincy to announce $85 million in grants through the MassWorks Infrastructure Program. Quincy received $2 million of these grants.
Today we're here to celebrate another phase, another step, another benchmark, if you will, in our new Quincy Center, the transformation of Quincy Center. And it's been a true partnership with tremendous private investment with some folks that are here today. We've had great public investment from our federal partners, our state partners, and of course, a commitment from our city council, most recently the vote of $80 million in bond authorization to the administration for further infrastructure work here for our downtown. But we wouldn't be able to keep the ball moving without the partnership we've had with the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. And if you've been by City Hall, we see the continued work on the Hancock Adams Green. The first phase of that work was due to Mass Works and Gateway City grants. Other infrastructure work in the downtown has been done through the help of Mass Works grants, as well as some grants from our federal government. So we as a community, as a city, we're fully committed, we're fully in, but we couldn't do without the partnerships at the state and federal level. And today, we celebrate another phase, another award.
One of the things we do as a Commonwealth is we invest in projects, we invest in people, and we invest in opportunities. And we make these decisions based on a competitive process. And when I say it's a competitive process, we typically receive somewhere between 50 to 100% more applications than we can actually fund. And that's through no fault of ours. We'd love to fund them all, but we work within a portfolio. And that portfolio, to some extent, is driven by our colleagues in the legislature who appropriate monies for this. But it's also driven by ensuring that we have resources to support a variety of projects for the environment, for economic development, for housing development, for downtown development, for gateway city development, and all the rest. And in this particular instance, I just want to say, in front of the delegation and on behalf of the folks from Quincy and in front of the mayor, part of the city's success on a variety of these initiatives has been due to the effort, the creativity, the imagination, and the follow-through and the execution that's been delivered on over and over again by the people here in Quincy. And for us, this is another $2 million MassWorks grant on top of several others that the mayor spoke to. But the simple truth of the matter is, yes, this is an investment that we, the Commonwealth, are making in this project. But the thing you should all know is it's also an investment we're making in the success we've seen and the demonstrated capacity to perform that we've seen over and over again from the folks here in Quincy.
These types of grants, Mass Work grants, are pretty easy for legislators to vote for. It came through the economic development bill, and it's a pretty big chunk of money overall, but we know that it's going to come back to local communities. It's going to come back in a very competitive way, a very wise way, and it's going to be used very well at the local level. So I want to thank the governor, the mayor, my colleagues, our councilors who are here who do a great job as well making sure that these funds are put to good use. So thank you to everybody, and let's get the shovels out. Thank you.
So this $2 million grant is going to get us to the next phase of the new road that's going to be built. Rather than two roads coming through here, there's going to be one roadway, and this will help with the infrastructure creating that roadway, which then sets the table for those lots that we can develop on. So it's exciting. We really appreciate the $2 million, Governor. It'll help us get this thing or continue to keep it moving. And hopefully in the coming weeks, we'll come to terms with Fox Rock that we can all live with and continue to move the project forward. So we thank everybody for being here, particularly the governor. And stay tuned, folks. Continue to move it. Appreciate all the effort from everybody here because so many people involved. They see engineering companies, our planning department, everybody involved. We have a great team. Thank you to everybody.
That's all for this episode of Quincy in Focus. On our next edition, we will take a look at the November election and highlights from the Veterans Day parade and ceremony. If you would like more information about Quincy Access Television, please call 617-376-1440 or visit our website at qatv.org. I am Vanessa Rizzitano, and thank you for watching this edition of Quincy in Focus.